Good morning, everyone. Can you all hear me if I have the microphone here? Is that fine? Great, perfect. So, Hebrews 11, verse 1. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. A verse that if you've spent any amount of time in a church setting, you've probably heard at least once, maybe a few more times. You might have seen it on a bookmark. Pretty sure I had a bookmark of it when I was younger. But what does it really mean? Good old Google defines faith as complete trust or confidence in someone or something, and strong belief in the doctrines of a religion based on spiritual conviction rather than proof. And Hebrews 11:1 is basically the Bible's definition of faith. So what do we do with that? Who here likes a mystery? Anyone? Yeah, good few people. There's more of you in this service who like mysteries than in the first service, so that's nice. I love a mystery. I love mystery books. I love mystery films. I love puzzles and riddles. But what I really love about them is solving them. Or getting to the end of the film or book and it being solved for you and you get to find out the answer and it all makes sense and you're like, oh, wasn't that interesting, like how all that was woven together. But getting the answer, knowing exactly how and why it all happened. What I really don't like is an unsolved mystery. When we were kids, my sister stayed with a family who had a really big old house. And there were more windows on the outside than there were on the inside. There was an extra window that you could see, and you couldn't get to it in the house. Nobody knew where it was, what it was. That still bugs me to this day. And I really still can't understand how you could live in a house for years and have an extra window and never like start dismantling the inside to figure out where it was. But that's no matter. I fundamentally do not like the unknown. We had chickens growing up, and I had to put them away at night, and usually it would get dark before I remembered, and you'd have to walk out round the back of the house to the chicken shed. And I was really afraid of the dark, so I used to ask my brother every single night, I was like, can you go and do it, or can you at least come with me? And he was like, Kez, you're not afraid of the dark, you're afraid of the unknown. Which, when you're eight, not any more helpful to know that. And to be honest, that just made everything worse because then you're like, great, now there's another thing I'm afraid of. But basically, I like to know what's happening, what's going to happen. I'm often that person watching movies with people who are like, what do you think is going to happen? Do you think it's going to be okay? And I like to watch films with people who've seen them before so that I can be like, just let me know if it's going to be scary and I'll get a pillow out, like. I like to be prepared and to know how everything's going to pan out. Anyone who's spent a lot of time with me will probably know by now that I ask a lot of questions. And generally, I like to get answers to those questions. And so I'll just go around until I find someone who has an answer. So how do we live our lives with such a great mystery? The mystery of God. Something we'll never fully get our heads around or grasp the sheer unknowable and unfathomableness of God. How do we do it? How did our ancestors do it? By faith. Faith is the substance, the reality of things hoped for, the proof and the demonstration of what we cannot see. We heard and saw listed several of the biblical forebears commended for their faith, examples given of their most notable moments of faith. And then in verse 13 it says, all these people were still living in faith when they died. It's amazing, really, isn't it? When you stop to think just how many people have lived years in faith and died in faith. Abraham didn't get to see the full outcome and delivery of the promise God made to him. But he did see it begin, and he looked ahead to not the promise on earth, but the promise in heaven. Those who have gone before maybe didn't see all the mysteries of their faith revealed in this life and on this earth, but each one of them has seen heaven, and that must be better by far. As the Message version says, each one of these people of faith died not yet having in hand what was promised, but still believing. How did they do it? They saw it way off in the distance, waved their greeting, and accepted the fact that they were transients in this world. People who live in this way make it plain that they are looking for their true home. And we know that heaven is our true home. So how do we live this faith journey? The road is long, and we don't know when we'll reach the destination. Our faith gives us certainty of the destination that we don't see, but we still have the day to day, and some days are a slog. Some days our faith shakes. Maybe some days it even breaks a little bit or a lot. How many of you have had days where you've thought, I don't know if I can keep doing this? There's so much going on, so much I can't understand, and I don't know how to keep faith when there is chaos all around. What do we do on those days? We trust God's faithfulness. We take our little bit of faith and we put it in God's faithfulness. Because even the smallest ounce of faith can have the biggest impact. We put our faith in God, and his faithfulness will do the rest. We say, God, I can't do this anymore. And he says, here, let me. Because in the moments where we can't walk anymore, he carries us. You look back over people in the Bible and others across history, they all had moments of shaking. Abraham, Sarah, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses. They all had moments of extreme doubt and weakness, and yet they all get specifically mentioned later in this passage for moments of faith in their lives. In many ways, I believe that the very existence of faith relies on the presence of doubt. I think they go hand in hand, because if we knew and had all the answers, we wouldn't need faith. Doubt allows our faith to be stronger. The more questions I have, the more doubts that rise, the harder I have to lean into the faith I have, believing that it will carry me through. I also think that talking about our doubts really helps. Talking on the days where faith seems hard, and sometimes that's really difficult because we don't want to admit that we have doubts or big questions and we feel like maybe we shouldn't have those doubts and questions. But I think more often than not, you'll find that in talking to someone else, they also have big questions and doubts. Maybe they have the same doubts and questions as you, and then you can just nicely sit together with those doubts and questions. Or maybe they have different doubts and questions, and together you can shed some light on each other's questions and doubts, or at least know that you're not alone, even if you don't have the answers. And there will always be questions that we won't get answers to in this life. My friends laugh because I always say I'll get to heaven with a really long list of all these questions that I'd like to get answered, and I'll sit down with Jesus and be like, before I get to eternity of like worshipping and all that fun stuff, I'd just like you to just, could you just clarify all these things, and then I'll be fine and we can carry on. But learning to sit with the tension of our faith is something I've been having to do and learn more about, Weirdly, more as I get older, because when I was younger, everything just seemed simple and black and white, and you were like, cool, that's how it works. And then you get older, and you realize that everything is incredibly nuanced. And I've had to learn that sometimes it's okay to not have an answer to things, and instead we just have to sit in the questions and the unknowing, as uncomfortable as that is. In Luke 12:32, Jesus says, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom." We know what God has promised, and we know from the Bible what God promised to those that have gone before us. And we get to see a little bit further down the line of that promise coming to fruition. And we can stand firmer on their faith that carried them as we live by our faith that will help carry those that come after us. As we share together the chain of faith that has been being built for centuries and generations grows even stronger. And it seeps into every part of our lives. I love how the Message version puts Hebrews 11:1. The fundamental fact of existence is that this trust in God, this faith, is the firm foundation under everything that makes life worth living. It's our handle on what we can't see. I think that's really beautifully put. Our faith is everything. It shapes our lives, and it's the lens through which we see the world around us. My faith is built on my experience of God, all the many, many times he's come through for me, all the times I've seen him work things out for my good, and even all the times he's just held me through the hard and painful times. And it's our handle on what we can't see, what we don't understand. It's what I cling to when nothing else seems to make sense, because I don't want to do this life thing without it. As much as there are days where everything feels blurry and chaotic and difficult and painful and it makes my faith feel shaky, I know that I wouldn't want to do all of that without my faith. And so I hold on to that handle. I put my faith in God's faithfulness, and I hope that you can too.